63 says, "Oh God, you are my God. Earnestly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My body longs for you in a dry and weary land where there is no water. I have seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power and your glory. Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands. My soul will be satisfied as with the richest of foods. With singing lips, my mouth will praise you." So I hope this morning that your soul is thirsting for the Lord. I hope you didn't just walk in here just to hear some music and hear a message and leave. I hope your soul is thirsting and longing for the Lord, because the only one who can satisfy is him. That last verse says, "My soul will be satisfied." So you can chase after a lot of things in this life, right? You can chase after money and power and likes and food and shopping. You can chase after a lot of things, but nothing is going to satisfy like the Lord. There's honey in the rock, water in the stone, manna on the ground, no matter where I go. I don't need to worry now that I know everything I need you've got. There's honey in the rock, there's honey in the rock. Praying for a miracle, thirsty for the living well. Only you can satisfy. See, now I've tasted, it's not hard to see. Sing that out. Only you can satisfy. There's honey in the rock. 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 Freedom where the Spirit is. In your land, power in the blood.
keep giving, you keep providing. strong and worship you. And if it puts me in the fire, I'll rejoice because you're there too. I won't be formed by feelings. I'll hold fast to what is true. And if the cross brings transformation, then I'll be crucified with you. Because death is just a doorway to resurrection life. And if I join you in your sufferings, then I'll join you when you rise. And when you return in glory with all the angels and the saints, my heart will still be singing, my song will be the same.
To be here in your presence this morning. Thank you that you always satisfy us, God. That we don't have to look anywhere else. That nothing else in this world matters, God, but you. God, thank you for the praises that were lifted high to your name this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Good morning. I think it's, there we go, Ridge West. Hope you are having a great fall morning in April. It was kind of weird, right? But we just want to say welcome and thank you for choosing to worship with us today. If you are a guest or if you have been here as long as we have been a campus, there's going to be a QR code on the screen. If you don't mind scanning that in a moment, or if you want to do the one that's on the front of your bulletin, you can do that. That way we get a record of your attendance. We can get you information about upcoming events, various things, and we can just stay in communication with you. There are a couple of specific things I want to point out to right on the front. We are having a fish fry Friday night. That was a lot of F's right there close together. That's an alliteration. I'm learning this. So we're having a fish fry this Friday, and there is a sign up out in the hallway if you want to come up and help with that, I believe. I'm going to give you some more information, but that's going to be here on Friday. And then secondly, on the inside, I know it's only April, but summer is coming. Yes, which I'm excited about as a teacher. Can't wait. But we need some volunteers for Vacation Bible School. So there's a piece right there in the middle that gives you some information towards that. It was a really cool time last summer. I had a whole lot of kids, way more than you would think, that were here. And so if you feel called in any way, even if it's to pack snacks, we need those people. You don't have to try to be an amazing teacher, but just come and be present, and we would greatly appreciate it. So those are a couple of events. And then lastly, if you have a Bible, go ahead and open up to Genesis 27. That's where we're going to be when James comes up in just a minute. And thank you for worshiping with us today.
After an introduction like that, I just feel like you're going to be disappointed. You know, I mean, how do you live up to that? I mean, that's pretty big. We're talking about wrestling with God for a few weeks, and specifically this morning, we're talking about wrestling with emotions. So I want to show something with you that I have brought, and let's say that you are thirsty. And I wrapped this up well because I didn't want to have an accident and spend the rest of my life in prison. So I have two bottles here, and let's say they're bottles of Gatorade. And I could, tell you to come on up here and you can grab a Gatorade and it's going to be cool and refreshing and you're going to enjoy it and it's going to be a great thing for you. And so if you were to come up and you were to pick one, someone else were to pick the other, the reality is one of you would be pleased and one of you would be going to the emergency room because this Gatorade I purchased in the store as is, but with this one, I ran out of a place to pour my extra antifreeze, and so this is not Gatorade. This is antifreeze, and if you know about antifreeze, it's dangerous when it leaks out of your car because a cat will get under your car. Antifreeze smells sweet and tastes sweet, and so an animal will digest antifreeze and it will kill him. And so you may look at this bottle and you may think, yeah, this is Gatorade. This is Gatorade. And you may really feel strongly, Pastor James wouldn't lead me astray. This, I know Gatorade, and this looks like Gatorade. But the reality is, if you drink this, it doesn't matter what you thought it was. It doesn't matter what your feelings were about being certain. What matters is the fact that there's no Gatorade in here, that this is antifreeze, and that this is poison. And so there are certain things in life that, you know, we think our thoughts are important or our feelings are important, but what's important is the truth. What's important is the facts, because the facts, knowing the facts, would get you something refreshing and not something that is going to poison you. So this morning, we're looking at Scripture in Genesis chapter 27, and we're going to see how emotions, how feelings can benefit us or can wreak havoc on our lives. This is Genesis 27, verse 41 and following. And, of course, Jacob has now deceived Esau and his father twice, or manipulated him twice, and because of that, Esau, the older brother, has lost his birthright and his blessing that the firstborn would receive, and Jacob has taken it. And says, verse 41, from that time on, Esau hated Jacob because their father had given Jacob the blessing. And Esau began to scheme, I will soon be mourning my father's death. Then I will kill my brother Jacob. But Rebekah heard about Esau's plans. So she sent for Jacob and told him, listen, Esau is consoling himself by plotting to kill you. So listen carefully, my son. Get ready and flee to my brother Laban in Haran. Stay there with him until your brother cools off. When he calms down and forgets what you have done to him, I will send for you to come back. Why should I lose both of you in one day? Verse 46, then Rebekah said to Isaac, I'm sick and tired of these local Hittite women. I would rather die than see Jacob marry one of them. And verse 46 seems random, but we'll get to the meaning of that in just a moment. As we saw last week, an underlying factor that we have to realize is family dysfunction between Rebekah and Isaac, between mom and between dad. And because of their family dysfunction, and we all have family dysfunction, there's no family, you know, someone will say, well, I came from a dysfunctional family. Welcome to the club, you know. We all came from a dysfunctional family. It's just a matter of how functional it was versus how dysfunctional it was. But this was pretty bad. There was open favoritism in the family, which ended up causing the twin boys to really compete against one another. And it didn't help that they were so very different. One's athletic, one's a homebody, one likes to hunt, one likes to cook. And so they already had kind of the challenge in themselves, but then you throw mom and dad there, and it's just a very dysfunctional family. And we see that here, and we see how it's beginning to affect them. So the first thing I want us to see when thinking about emotions is this. Emotions are experienced by all people. That's a fact. Emotions are experienced by all people. They are not sinful, but can lead to sin. They are not sinful, but can lead to sin. Some of us have this idea that love and joy and peace are good emotions, but like hatred and resentment are bad emotions, and therefore they are sin. But that's not really what Scripture says. Scripture suggests that all emotions are a part of us being human. Look at verse 41 again. From that time on, Esau hated Jacob because their father had given Jacob the blessing, and Esau began to scheme, "I will soon be mourning my father's death. Then I will kill my brother Jacob." And so notice, the emotion is hatred. But that emotion of hatred, and let's be honest, if you have been tricked and manipulated and lied to have your blessings taken in this society, so your inheritance has been cut in half unfairly, and the words of your father to bless you and bless your children and grandchildren and words meant so much to them, those words have been robbed from you, you would feel hatred too. I mean, that emotion would bubble up in you. But that's not what's so wrong here. What's so wrong here is he takes that emotion, he embraces it, and then he goes to revenge. He schemes to kill his brother. Now, how do we know that emotion in itself is not sin? In the Bible book of James, you're probably familiar with the verse, "Do not let the sun go down on your anger. In your anger, do not sin." And the idea there is when you are angry with someone, deal with it as soon as you can. Talk it out. Talk it through. And in your anger, do not sin. In other words, you have anger. That's not sin, but that anger sure can lead you to sin. So if someone does something to you, or you're just having a bad day and you feel that emotion of anger, and it may feel red hot in you, it may feel really negative in you, that's being a human, right? That's life. But what Scripture is saying, that emotion can lead you to violence, can lead you to say crushing and harmful things, can lead you to really be a person no one wants to be around, because you're always walking around with a chip on your shoulders, you're always walking around angry. And so Scripture says the emotion is not sin, but emotions can lead us to sin. So what do we do with negative emotions? You know, I think there's really two extremes that we can go to. And one extreme is we hold on. We begin to embrace that emotion. We begin to embrace that anger or that resentment or that hatred or that feeling of being wrong. And we just hold on to it. And many people can build a life out of their anger and resentment and bitterness. And their life, if you get to know them, you begin to see that the theme of their life is, "I have been wronged, and I am going to hold on to that the rest of my life." And they may feel justified. They may feel like, well, if you had been in my shoes, you would feel this way too. But the problem is they're drinking a poison themselves. They're ruining their lives. You're ruining your life when we just hold on to those negative emotions. So we can hold on, or we can throw it away, right? We can throw it away. Now, I'm not trying to be simplistic here, because I know there's some things that are pretty heavy. Have you ever had, and I have four females in my household, my wife and my three daughters with long hair. So sometimes I'll find a hair, you know, on the counter. Let's say I'm dusting or something, and I'll take that hair and I'll like go to the trash can, I'll throw it away, and I'm like, okay, it's gone. And then I'll walk around the house, I look at my hand a minute later, and it's like, oh no, it's still there. And I go to the trash can, I throw it away, and I'm like, and I come back, and oh, it's still there. And it's like it takes multiple times of throwing that thing away before it finally gets off my finger, and there's stuff like that in life that happens to us, that sometimes we want to say to someone, oh, forgiveness is just pray a prayer and tell God that you forgive so-and-so for doing such-and-such, or tell that person you forgive them, and then you just walk away and everything's easy and okay. And that's silly. That's crazy. I mean, if someone offends you in a minor way, and they say they're sorry, and you, I accept your apology, I forgive you. Yeah, we can move on from that emotionally. But someone deeply harms you or scars you, it's not so easy. And so when I say throw away, understand that may be a process of days, weeks, months, years, or a lifetime to feel that you are free of that. And so we need to make that decision. Now, sometimes when it's really hard, it's not something we do on our own. It's something we find a mentor. We find someone we look up to, and we talk to them about what we've been through and about how we deal with it. We go to a pastor and say, do you have an hour of time? I need to talk to you about something I've been through. I need to help process this. Or you find a counselor you can go to. But you take steps to let go of the emotion that is holding you back and is pulling you down. And the second thing is, emotion should be a gauge, not a guide. Emotion should be a gauge, not a guide. I've had a tire slowly leaking air in my front driver's side tire on my car, and I've carried around a small battery-operated compressor in my car. So instead of getting the tire, you know, replaced, which I finally did yesterday, every two or three days, I would, you know, when I got home or when I was about to leave, I'd put some air in that tire, and then the compressor broke. And I'm like, oh, man. So I decided I'm going to fix this thing. I'm going to take it apart. You know, it's one of those things, they designed it so you couldn't possibly take it apart if you wanted to, which just challenges me to say, oh, you just wait, and I'm going to do this. And after about 20 minutes, I begin to decide what's the cost of buying a new one and versus the cost of frustration to me trying to fix this one. And so I just gave up, got their tire replaced, and got a new compressor. But it has two functions on it. One function is a gauge. And so when you connect it to the tire, it tells you the amount of air pressure that you have in the tire so that you know if you have enough or you need more. And so that gauge doesn't really do anything. It doesn't change anything, but it lets you know what's going on. It's simply a measurement of what's happening. But then you have a guide. And a guide is something that it tells you, go this way, do this. It takes action. And so I push a button on that compressor, and it starts to pump air into the tire. It's doing something. And emotions for us should be a gauge. Emotions should let us know what is going on inside of me. And why is that happening? And what do I need to do about it? But when emotions become a guide, when we feel anger, and because of that anger, we automatically lash out. When we feel resentment, and because of that resentment, we just sour our attitude and we become difficult to be around. When we allow emotions to be a guide, it hinders us. It harms us. So we have to be cautious to know that emotion is real, but it's a gauge of what's going on inside of us. And what a lot of us do is we appropriately read the gauge, and we realize that there is some discomfort. And there's something that's not right inside of us, but instead of dealing with it, we go to a distraction, right? We go to a favorite hobby or pastime or even an addiction because we don't want to deal with it. So emotion should be a gauge and let us know something's not right there. Proverbs 29:11 says, "Fools vent their anger, but the wise quietly hold it back." So a fool has the emotion. Instead of just recognizing that's a gauge, that something's wrong, it becomes a guide, and they just lash out. It's where someone who is wise recognizes the emotion, but holds on to it. You know, I can't help but in this sermon, but to think about our group Mothers of Pearls, that Felicia, is her ministry she'll be leading in a couple of Saturdays, this Saturday before Mother's Day, and most of the people who attend here are mothers who have lost a child due to violence. And if you talk to these ladies, they have had the worst imaginable tragedy come upon their family. I mean, we're not talking about something minor. We are talking about their child taken away in most of them, a needless act of violence. And I don't know about you. I don't know how handle that. I don't know how I could possibly process that. But as you hang around these ladies and as you hear their stories, you recognize there is something inside of them that at some point they begin to veer their lives away from, I'm going to hold on to this bitterness. I'm going to hold on to this resentment. I'm going to hold on to this hatred. I'm going to hold on to this unforgiveness. At some point, they begin to veer away and say, I'm not going to let all of that define my life and rob me of the life that God still has for me. And they begin to one step at a time veer away from that. And it's not cut and dry. It's not an easy thing. I can't imagine. But they surround themselves with some other people they can cry to, they can scream at, they can process through, and they begin to say, I'm not going to allow all of that dark emotion to rob me of my future. And man, you hear their stories and you hear their testimonies and you see their lives, and it can't help but to minister to you. That when we hold on to things, when we hold on to anger and resentment and bitterness, we're allowing our lives to be robbed as well. The third thing and the final point is this: feelings affect how we live. Feelings affect how we live, but facts should be the foundation of what we believe and how we live. So feelings affect how we live. I mean, there's no question. When you have an emotion, particularly in response to something that has happened to you, good or bad, it does affect you. It affects your life. It affects how you live. And we can't just say that emotions are it's a, you know, its own compartment. It has its own place in my life, and they don't bother me. They don't affect me. That's not a way to live. Feelings do affect us. But feelings should not be the foundation of what we believe and of how we live. And I think you know where I'm going with this. In our society, that's just been thrown to the side. That's just been thrown away. People base their life view, their worldview, they base it upon how they feel. They base decisions, they base right and wrong upon how they feel. And they want to throw away what Scripture says. They want to throw away what common morality says. They want to throw away the rules that we have had for generation after generation after generation. And you ask them about it, and they'll tell you about their feelings. They'll tell you about how they feel and how rules should make other people feel. But you ask them about the facts, you ask them about what underlies what you are saying, and the conversation veers back into feelings. There's a danger when we take emotions, when we take our feelings, and we make that the foundation of how we live our lives, about how we treat others, about how we handle what is right and what is wrong. Feelings should not determine what we do. Facts should determine what we do. Feelings help us to understand what's going on and in a sense, give us some direction, but feelings don't determine what we do. This interesting verse at the end, you probably wondered about this. Verse 46, then Rebekah, mom, says to Isaac, dad, I'm sick and tired of these local Hittite women. I would rather die than see Jacob marry one of them. Now, let me just say a couple of quick things here. Number one, that sounds racist, but if you understand the background of it, that's not really the point here or the idea behind this. Remember, Abraham had been called out of polytheism, had been called out of worshiping multiple gods, city gods, state gods, family gods, a god of this, a god of that, and there was a lot of immorality that went with that. Abraham had been called out of that and had chosen to believe there is one true God, the creator of the universe, who was in charge of everything. And so Abraham with his children and his grandchildren, the idea was we are going to be a new people. We are going to be a new nation that follows the one true living God. And yet what has happened is you have Esau has married someone from the local area that they had traveled to, and she worships multiple gods. And she has the same morality that they had tried to get away from. And so that has taken them away from obeying the Lord faithfully. And so that's why this is really not motivated by race. It's motivated by a faithfulness to the one true God. But notice here what she is saying. She is saying this not because she doesn't want God to be offended by the choices her sons make and who they marry. That's not why she's saying it. She's saying it because she wants to manipulate her husband. She wants her husband to think it's his idea to send Jacob away back to the homeland. She's doing this not based on the facts, based on, hey, God would want your son to marry a woman who loves the one true God, who is a worshiper of the one true God. That's not what she bases it on. She bases it on her feelings. I want my son to escape. I don't want him to be a danger. I'm afraid, so I'm going to manipulate. I'm going to trick my husband into sending him away, make him think this whole thing is his idea. Look at Hebrews chapter 12, verse 15 and 16. It says, look after each other so that none of you fails to receive the grace of God. Watch out so that no poisonous root of bitterness grows up to trouble you, corrupting many. Make sure that no one is immoral or godless like Esau, who traded his birthright as the firstborn for a single meal. I want you to grab hold of that phrase, a poisonous root of bitterness. So I get offended at some point in my life. It's something that someone said to me or didn't say to me. Something that someone did to me or didn't do to me. And that wounds me, that hurts me, that angers me. That makes me feel left out, or that makes me feel somehow not valuable to them. And so I hold on to that and to that the offense. And I don't forgive. I don't process through it. I don't talk it out with a trusted, mature friend. I don't talk it out with a pastor, a counselor. I just hold on to that. And maybe it wasn't that big of a deal, but it was an offense. And I hold on to it. And when that offense comes back to my mind, I process it. I mean, not process it in a healthy way. I'm like, yeah, that does make me mad. Yeah, I was wrong. That was unfair. And you hold on to it, and days become weeks, become months, become years, and it becomes more painful. It becomes stronger. And this root grows down inside of your life, inside of your heart. And what flourishes, the plant that comes up is not a thing of beauty. It's a thing that is ugly, that is harmful. I have a confession to make. I enjoy picking weeds. Like when I take the dog on a walk and I go past a neighbor's yard and they've got a really, you know, really big weed. I have been stopped by my family. I don't do it anymore very often. But my temptation is to get down and to pull that weed, especially if the ground is moist. Because if the ground is moist, when you pull the weed up, you get the whole thing up. You get the weed up and you get all the roots. And there are very few things in life that you can do in one step and it's accomplished. Like you can check the box. Yeah, that weed's gone. I got the roots and everything. And so there's something about that that is therapeutic to me to pull that root up, to pull that weed out of the ground. No, I'm not coming to your house to pull your weeds, okay? Look at my front yard and you'll see that I don't always practice what I preach. But there's something about pulling those roots up and knowing it's not coming back in this same place. I'm successful in this one thing. And see, when that root of bitterness, when we hold on to it, when we live our lives based upon it, when our outlook is poisoned by it, we've allowed that offense that may have been huge or it may have been small, but we have allowed that fence, that offense to be a root that has now poisoned us. It has grown. It has become bitter. It has become poisonous. And it says it affects others. Others look at your life and they see there's something negative inside. There's something bitter inside. There's some anger inside. There is a hard edge that I can't crack through and I don't know why, but you know there's a root of bitterness inside. The SS Principis Jolanda was the pride of Italy in the year 1907. It was their first Italian genuine luxury transatlantic boat. And so you could go on a cruise across the Atlantic. It was steam powered. And I mean, it was such an event that when it was launched out of dry dock into the water, there were onlookers that came. There were press from even from other countries. There were political figures there, all so they could see this ship be launched. It was the first transatlantic ship that had wireless, a telegraph. All the rooms had electric lighting, and every room had a telephone in it. So, I mean, it was way ahead of its time, and they were so overjoyed. And the moment came for the public launch, for it to come out down the chute from dry launch into the water. And the moment that it hit the water, it became apparent that it started to list to one side. And pretty quick, it became aware that it was listing more and more. So they drop anchors on the other side. They're trying to do what they can to stabilize the boat. But within about 18 minutes, the ship had listed so bad to one side that water began to go into the portholes and begin to sink the ship. And within an hour, the ship was officially sunk, and it was gone. And they of course launched an investigation to see what happened to the pride of Italy, the ship that didn't even make one round across the Atlantic. What happened? And they realized a couple of things. Number one, they had put all the furnishings inside the ship before they put it into the water. And when the ship began to list at first, what happened is all that furniture, all those supplies began to move across the floor and go to one side of the ship, which made it list even more. And they hadn't put any ballast or coal in the ship. So the coal that would be used to run the steam engines, the tons of coal that they would put in there, and the ballast, which would be gravel or some kind of weights in the bottom of the ship to keep it down far enough in the water, they hadn't put it in yet. And so the balance of the ship was thrown off, and the center of gravity was too high. And the center of gravity is too high on a ship, it's not going to stay upright in the water. It's going to topple to one side. And I think emotions have a way of doing that to us. When we hold on to negative emotions, when we allow them to dominate us, then we get thrown, the center of gravity gets to be too high. I almost spilled the poison here. Don't want to do that. The center of gravity gets to be too high. We get thrown off balance. And so instead of accomplishing what we want to accomplish in life, instead of doing what people are cheering us on to do in life, we end up going underwater, and we become useless to others and to ourselves. I don't know what emotion that you are struggling with today. If you're struggling with too much joy and too much happiness and too much contentment, praise God, why don't you come up here and preach the next sermon, okay? I mean, you should. But if you're struggling with some resentment or some bitterness or some forgiveness or some anger or something, and it's just got a clutch on you, I hope you take from the Word of God today the simple fact that emotion may not be sin, but inviting it to live in your life as a pet, as a hobby, as a constant companion, that's sin. Because it's poisoning you. It's poisoning your family. It's poisoning those around you. Find a mentor. Find a trusted, mature friend, a pastor, a counselor. Process through that. Don't allow that one offense to grow roots so deep in your life that you lose the joy that God wants you to have and that God wants for your life. And know that when you try to throw it away, it's going to be sticky. And you're going to have to do this a lot. And you're going to have to go back to the trash can. Because forgiveness is almost never a one-time decision. It's like peeling an onion. You forgive, and it's a layer. And then it comes back, and you forgive, and it's another layer. And you eventually peel it and get smaller and smaller and smaller. But let's deal with it so we can experience a life God has for us. Lord, we are so grateful for your word because... God, sometimes the stuff we see on TikTok or on Facebook or on YouTube is just flat out idiotic advice that causes us to go into our minds, into our hearts, and live a life as victims, to live a life feeling powerless and out of control and avoiding people, avoiding relationships. And God, so often our society pushes us down back inside ourselves to embrace that anger and resentment and unforgiveness and that offense. And we end up in bondage. We end up with a seed that becomes a root that grows deeper and deeper. And as people begin to see it blossom out of us, what they see is not pretty and it's not beautiful and it doesn't bring us joy. God, we don't want to beat ourselves up for having negative emotions. It's a part of being human. We all at times feel some hatred, some resentment, some bitterness. We all at times feel offense. But God, may we confront those feelings. May we process those feelings. May we talk them out in a healthy way with someone else who can help us process through that, can help us take steps of moving beyond that. God, if there's anyone here today who has been so harmed or so assaulted or abused that they are hopeless of getting past this emotion, Lord, would they come talk to me? Would they come talk to a Christian brother or sister in Christ who can get them the help that they need from a counselor, someone that can walk with them through a longer, more difficult journey than most of us are experiencing? But for those of us who just were struggling with this run-of-the-mill, just life, just getting hurt by this or by that in life, may we start taking some steps of freedom. May we start taking some steps of letting go and of entrusting it in your hands, God. You're a good God, and thank you for teaching us. As we sing a song of worship, this is just a time to respond. Maybe God has really penetrated your heart, and you want to come to the altar and just pray and begin to let something go. Maybe you want to come talk to me. I'll be up front. You can come talk to me. Wherever you are, this is a time to reflect on what God has done in your life, to respond as we worship him together with song. Let's stand and sing.
My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious. Deacons, come forward. We're going to take our tithes and offerings. Let's pray. Lord, you are so good to us. God, we love you. And now we give our gifts to you, God. We sacrifice, God. We sacrifice for you. Help us to give with joyful hearts and use this money for your kingdom and for your glory. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Welcome to Walnut Ridge, where our mission is to love God, love others, and make disciples. Grab your church merch t-shirts and get the conversation started. We are taking pre-orders in spring and summer colors. The online store will close tonight at midnight with shirts available for pickup in early May. This batch of t-shirts is all in the Comfort Colors t-shirt brand. Order your conversation starter today. Women's Retreat is back with the title and focus of rest. Women of the Ridge, join us November 1st through the 3rd for two nights, four meals, worship, games, and massive amounts of laughter. It will be a special time to connect with the Lord and one another. It's also a first Monday weekend for those who want to shop at Canton. Space is limited, so reserve your spot today. Spring Community Outreach is right around the corner on May 5th. Help revitalize our community one property at a time. Join us for a day of service as we do church in our community by completing various projects. Signups are online, in the app, website, or main foyer. Let's be the hands and feet of Jesus in our community and spread the love of Christ to our neighbors. Summer is right around the corner with our kids and student ministry gearing up for their best summer ever. Get your calendars out now. Starting off, we have Kids Camp May 30th through June 3rd. Join us at River Bend, an unforgettable overnight camp designed for students who have completed third through sixth grade. Your kids will have a blast with a variety of activities, and beyond the excitement, they will also have the opportunity to strengthen their relationship with God through worship and Bible study. And finally, for kids who aren't quite ready for a week of overnight camp, kids ages kindergarten through third are invited to experience Sky Ranch for five fun-filled days at Walnut Ridge. With an emphasis on developing relationships and building trust, Sky Ranch counselors encourage your child to do this. Practice social and communication skills, try new things, learn who Jesus is, and come home exhausted with great stories to tell. More information about these events can be found in the bulletin or mobile app. Thank you so much for worshiping with us today.
So do we have a camp to teach adults social skills and communication skills? I mean, sign me up for that one. I forgot all of that. We're glad you're here. I don't know if you noticed, but in the bulletin, we've kind of revamped it because at times, honestly, it was confusing. What's at the West Campus? What's at 360? And what's for us? What's not? That sort of thing. And so in here now, it's really clear what's going on here. We have the sermon notes in here now. And then on the back, we've actually kind of added a this week at the Ridge section and then all the upcoming significant dates because you hear announcements and you know things are going on, but this gives you kind of one place for the information. We have a group of men going fishing on Tuesday. We're meeting at 3:30 a.m. at the 360 campus parking lot to go to Lake Texoma. And we are going to fish, and we're doing the manly kind of fishing. Well, actually, we're doing the easy kind of fishing where the guy does most of the work. We just kind of do the casting and the reeling. We are filled. We don't have any spaces, but if you want to ask Jeremy if there is anyone who drops out the next day, you can ask him. He'll let you know that. But with the fish that we catch, we are going to have a feast or a famine. We're going to have a feast, we pray, on Friday night here at 6:30, 6:30 to 8. And to make sure that we cook up enough fish and have enough sides, we do encourage you to sign up. There's a QR code somewhere out there where you can just sign up to let us know you're coming or let us know that you can bring a side, something to go along with fish. Bring the family, friends, kids, come one, come all. We just want to make sure we have enough for everyone. So make sure that you take part of that. Ladies, women's retreat is very limited. Number of spaces is over halfway filled after just a week or two. So if you're interested in that, check that out and go ahead and get signed up for that. And finally, if you're new to Walnut Ridge, this can be your very first time. We've had people go to lunch with the pastor on their very first Sunday because it was announced. Whether you've been here one time or 10 times or 3 years, and you've wondered, what is this church really about? Is this the kind of church that would be a fit for me? And you might have questions or want to know, what does membership look like here? We have a brief, informal lunch with the pastor every couple of months. It's today. We have some sandwich from some subs from Fireman's Deli, and we will be in this classroom right here, the next step room. And we just invite you, once the service is over, to head in there, grab a sandwich, sit down at a table, and then in about 5 minutes, I'll be in there, and we'll kind of start. I'll just share a little bit. This is a no-pressure, getting-to-know-you sort of thing, and then there'll be some Q&A, and then you can head home. But it's just sort of casual, relaxed time to get to know a few other people and learn a little bit about the life and the vision and the heartbeat of this church. So you're welcome to stay and be a part of that. With that, let's pray together, and we'll be done. God, we are so grateful that your scripture speaks to us where we live, and sometimes we live in dark places and have dark emotions and dark experiences. And God, the word of Jesus and the word of God brings light into dark places. And so we want to open up those places when they are exposed. And we want the light of Jesus, the love of Jesus, the joy of Jesus, the truth of Jesus to fill us. And so help us with that battle to take it a day at a time, and to constantly be looking to you, because we know that what you have for us is what's best for us. Lord, we love you. We love this church family, and we love your word. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless.